Salutations, celestial sightseers. I'm David Fuller. Welcome to Eyes on the Sky. What's up this week? Well, the arguably the best planet to view in the solar system, Saturn, reached opposition on July 9th. And that means that it's really an evening sky object because it's been visible in the morning sky for a number of months now. So this I have set at 10 o'clock for me at 40 degrees north latitude. That means most people should be able to see Saturn as well. Even if you are further north than me, it ought to be up. I like to wait until Saturn is about 15 degrees above the horizon before viewing it. So when we look on Stellarium at the azimuth grid, you can see that at 10 o'clock for me, it's at maybe 16 degrees or so. So that's high enough up that you can at least start getting some decent views of it. You can view it lower than that, but very often that there's so much more atmosphere that you're looking through that the view is not quite as good as it should be, or could be, I guess, really is the better way to say that. So ideally, we want to look at Saturn when it is on the meridian. So that means for right now, we really need to kind of go around 1 o'clock in the morning. So kind of late for a lot of people, but that would be the best time to see it because it's going to be about, for me, 27 degrees or so up. Actually, we can look and see exactly how high it is. We just click on Saturn and look over here, and you can see on the as altitude side, 26.47. That's the best we're going to do, and it does not get substantially better through the next several months, unfortunately, because the ecliptic stays fairly low to the sky just based on how things are, at least here in the northern hemisphere. So this is going to be your best opportunity when it's due south. The other ways that you can get a good view of the planet, you can go to my website, eyesonthesky.com, go under the resources section, click on the See the Planets Better link, and I've got a number of things that you can do to get a better view of planets in general that are going to help you to have a better observing session of planets. So we have both Jupiter and Saturn out there. If we look at about 10 o'clock or so, we can see that Saturn is, it's around 30 degrees away from Jupiter. So finding Saturn is not all that difficult. Actually, I'm going to skip ahead to get it a little bit higher up in the sky. So this is right around 11 o'clock or so. At 11 o'clock, Jupiter is just to the right of south and Saturn is to the left of south. That 30 degrees distance you can measure by holding your hands out like this, and it's the distance across your pinkies held at arm's length, because each of these is about 15 degrees. So you can do that and find Saturn fairly easily. The other thing is look for it to be, I would say it is technically as bright as Arcturus at about zero magnitude. There it is, 0.06, and Arcturus way up here, 0.15. So they're almost identical in the magnitude. The problem is you're looking through more atmosphere probably for Saturn, and as a result, it may look dimmer. It does for me. Arcturus looks pretty bright. Saturn does not look quite as bright. But finding Jupiter is simple because it's the next brightest thing after the moon. If the moon doesn't happen to be in your sky because we're a couple weeks ahead, then just look for Jupiter towards the south and then look for Saturn. It's in the constellation of Sagittarius. When we bring up those lines, we can see how it is kind of to the handle part of the teapot. Antares is very close to where Jupiter is over in Scorpius. And for Sagittarius, we got the teapot right here. Saturn doesn't move a whole lot relative to Sagittarius over the next couple of months either. If we center that and just kind of go ahead, even a couple of months, you can see how it just sort of sits there right by the handle. It's not going to move substantially in order to be able to find it. And it actually doesn't move a lot relative to Jupiter. They're both going to be in the same relative part of the sky towards the south there, and then about the same distance apart. To view the planet well, you're going to need some magnification. Magnification should not go crazy because if you try to go more than about 50 times per inch or 50 times per 25 millimeters of aperture for your telescope, you're really just magnifying mush at that point. You're not getting any substantial additional resolution on your telescope image for observing. So try to limit that unless the atmosphere is really, really, really super steady, then maybe you can push it up more. But go ahead and go up to the maximum that you think you can go, and if it looks bad, just then keep backing off until you get a nice steady image of the planet. When you do look at it, there's a number of things that you can see. Titan is one of the moons. It's quite obvious because it's 8.5 magnitude, so that's as bright as a lot of stars that are easily visible in most any telescope. And then we've got a couple other dimmer moons, Rhea, Dione, and Tethys, which go around, and you're gonna watch. Well, I'm gonna show you really quickly how Titan kind of makes this big giant loop around Saturn because Saturn's tilted right now, so the plane of the moon's orbits of Saturn are also tilted as a result. So as we kind of skip, whoops, let me back up. I gotta center this. So as we go through, you can see how Titan makes that big giant elliptical loop around, and it gets a pretty good distance away too. Don't confuse it with a star. And you should be able to see those other three moons. Seeing some of the other ones might be pretty difficult. Enceladus is 12th magnitude. That's pretty difficult. Mimas is 13th magnitude. Good luck with that one. And some of the other ones are even dimmer than that. That just gets really difficult to see some of those. So definitely those four. And then, of course, there's the rings. The rings are lovely. Check this out. Isn't that amazing? And people get mesmerized so much by the rings, they forget to look at the actual planet itself. Don't forget to look for a couple interesting things, especially because of how the planet is. Notice the shadow. That's going to help give kind of that 3D view of it. That's what makes people look at it and they go, wow, are you sure that's not a picture at the end of your telescope? Nope, that's really the planet. It's really 80 light minutes away, which is almost like 900 million miles. It's a long way off. You can look for the subtle shading and banding on the planet itself. You're going to need some magnification for that. It's not as obvious as Jupiter's bands, but you can sometimes see that. But the rings themselves are where things definitely get interesting. We can know kind of where certain rings are by their location. So it looks like there's a lot of different rings in here, and there are a number of ring features, but I'm going to bring up the Wikipedia page for this so you can kind of see. And they've even got a big slider here so you can see the difference. So the A ring and B ring are the biggest components and the brightest ones. So the A ring is going to be way out here. B ring is out here. So if we go back to our thing, we've got A ring and then B ring. This dark line in between there, that's the Cassini division. So Cassini saw that, and that's why we call that that. In here is the C ring. That's faint, or I should say really dark. It's not so much faint, it's just dark. And then the D ring is even inside of that. I don't think I've ever seen the D ring before. So primary components really that you're looking for are A and B ring, just because when we back out and get a typical view of what a telescope might look like, you're probably looking at that and trying to find that Cassini division. If you have really, really steady skies though, and you can bump up that magnification because you've got enough aperture to do so, try and look for the Encke division right here, way out there. I'm going to show this to you right there. That, or they call it the Encke gap here on this. That's only like 200 miles wide or just over 300 kilometers wide. So keep that in mind as you look for that and realize that it might be difficult to see something that seems big, but that far away, it's really, 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 really small. But Saturn is, of course, an amazing object to see. We're going to be able to see it for a couple of months before we kind of lose it. Fortunately, the skies get darker earlier as we go out of summer and into fall, so we can skip ahead. There's September. If we back up a little bit in time, you can see how even in October, we're still due south, but we're not any higher. The azimuth still has us at like 27 degrees, but you can find it, you can see it for a number of months in the evening. Definitely go do it. It's the best planet to see. That's all for this week. Keep your eyes on the sky and your outdoor lights aimed down so we can all see what's up. I'm David Fuller, wishing you clear and dark skies.